بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الحمد لله حمدا يوافي نعمه ويكافئ مزيده يا ربنا لك الحمد كما ينبغي لجلال وجهك وعظيم سلطانك سبحانك لا نحصي ثناء عليك أنت كما أثنيت على نفسك نستغفرك ونتوب إليك وأفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم على سيد الأولين والآخرين وقائد الغر المحجلين وعلم السابقين وشفيع المذنبين وسيد ولد آدم أجمعين اللهم صل وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله الغر الميامين وأصحابه نجوم الدين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وعنا معهم برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين اللهم لا سهل إلا ما جعلته سهلا وأنت تجعل الحزن إذا شئت سهلا اللهم انفعنا وارفعنا بالقرآن العظيم اللهم اجعله لنا نورا وإماما وهدى ورحمة اللهم ألهمنا رشدنا وأعذنا من شرور أنفسنا أما بعد brothers and sisters I was asked to speak with you about one of the dearest subjects you know, that I have but to be honest with you whenever I speak about this subject or the subject of the Prophet ﷺ, even though I love to speak a lot you know, about them, in the meanwhile I feel myself frightened you know, of speaking about them. Because here, I'm not here to prove that the Qur'an is the word of Allah. I'm here to scale myself according to these matters, okay? So if I'm successful, that's me, alhamdulillah, I have good grade, you know, in the relation to the Qur'an al-Kareem. When I'm not successful, that means my word and my position is not that good, you know, with the Holy Qur'an. So this is the way I look at myself, and I would like all of you, if you hear from me something that convinced you, that's it. Otherwise, just search again, because the Qur'an is very great matter. The Prophet ﷺ is a very great matter, you know, and we should spend, even if we spend all of our life searching and building up our knowledge about these matters, you know, because these are parts of our religion, and our religion doesn't mean a lot, you know, without them. That's why I'm going to share certain points, you know, with you, regarding what I look at the Qur'an, the way I look at the Qur'an. The first point, which I think is very important one, and many people, they look at it in the opposite way of my look. It's, I look at the Qur'an as a phenomenon or a reality in my life. I don't prove the Qur'an through the history of the Qur'an. I would rather say I prove the history of the Qur'an by the Qur'an. In another word, what I'm trying to say, you have this book, you know, among yourself. Whether you know from where did it come or not, you feel that you are facing a phenomenon in your life, and this is extraordinary, and you should know how to deal with it. To be honest with you, most of our life is not going to be built about the resource or the history of these matters. Now I'm present to you. You have this reality in front of you. You may not know my background. You may not know my shuyukh. You may not know this or that. But you should judge me and know me according to what I'm speaking about. Even the famous people in our time, usually they look at them, they are going to be from their presence and their reality much more than their history and background. And I would, so that's why from this point I look, as I said before, I'm going to prove the history of the Qur'an through the Qur'an and not the opposite, okay? I have something here in my life called al-Qur'an al-Kareem. I have this matter which I look at it as an extraordinary matter. And This by itself, it's an enough evidence for me. Even though I'm going to speak with you about how the Qur'an was transmitted and you name it, okay? And I would like to look at the Prophet in the same way. I don't judge the Prophet or look at him through his seerah. No, I'm going to look to the seerah of the Prophet through himself. You got my point? Why do I say so? Because I still there in Syria, we used to have many of those Western students, Muslim students, they come to seek Islamic knowledge, you know. And I observed that many of them, they seek to know the history of the Qur'an to prove the Qur'an. Which in my case, or in my view, it's not a good idea, okay? Here you have something in your life. You should try to explain. And that's what most of the scientific matters and theories and experiments took place, okay? When they found that they have this disease, they are going to try to find out what's the reason of it, what's the history of this disease, how did it come, and you name it, okay? And in another way, they are trying to build many of the data that they give to us upon the presence of this matter. And this is the look should be in the Qur'an. And whenever anyone, I think, look at the Qur'an from this way, is going to be really impressed by the Qur'an. And then it's a good idea to try to ask himself, how did it come, how was it transmitted, and you name it. This is the first point that I would like to highlight. The second point that I would like to highlight you have riwayah and diraya, or science which relate or depend completely on transmission, and others on experiment. We shouldn't get ourselves, you know, mixed up with each other. Correct me if I'm wrong, the Western people, they tend to look at everything from the experiment. This is maybe right for medicine, for computer sciences, for this or that. But for religion, it's not good at all. I would rather say it's a very bad one. Why? Because the religion, in my definition, it's the relation between Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his slaves. And here, you have dominant portion. And wherever you have as such, the other one should just be dictated, you know, and instructed from the first one. If I'm not going to accept anything of Islam, unless I'm going to have a trial about it, or experiment, or this, really I'm going to be in very bad shape. Why? Because I'm limited. I have some skills or whatever, but regardless of my skills or whatever, it's not going to prove everything for me. And this is what has been mentioned firstly by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say in the verse number 65 in Surah An-Nisa? فَلَا وَرَبِّكَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ حَتَّى يُحَكِّمُوكَ فِي مَا شَجَرَ بَيْنَهُمْ ثُمَّ لَا يَجِدُوا فِي أَنفُسِهِمْ حَرَجًا مِمَّا قَضَيْتَ وَيُسَلِّمُوا تَسْلِيمًا. That's where by the Lord of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they are not believers till they seek your judgment for any dispute among themselves, you know, and they are not going to find even any negative feeling against it in their heart and come with full submission. And this is the way I understand the religion by. When I want to subject all of these commands in the Qur'an to my experience, let's assume, which is almost impossible, I'm in 99% successful, you know, and convinced, you know, by this command or prohibition. And in 1% I am inaccurate. Am I right or wrong? I'm completely wrong. Why? Because I'm judging Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I'm judging the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through the things given to me by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And by very simple way, you know, anything or anyone done by someone else, the other one has the dominance on it. No way that the computer is going to govern the man who firstly made it. No way the car is going to drive the driver. And here, whenever we try to use it in the opposite way, even though, which is impossible, I said, we are accurate 99%, we are completely wrong. Can any scholar, can any scientist nowadays say that we gain, let's say, 60% of the knowledge of the humanity in physics, chemistry, medicine, and space, and whatever? No, he cannot say so. Because as you see, the development, you know, of the humanity all the time, you have something new, you have some improvement, and you name it. Okay. So how I'm going to judge the Quran according to the setting that I have nowadays? And I know it's deficiency. I am a medical physician, okay? In medicine, you have very great areas, you know, which will be really bad, you know, after 100 years or whatever, you know. And nowadays, we have very bad areas. That medicine is completely not developed, you know, in these fields. And this is not only for medicine. This is for all human experimental sciences. And to subject the Quran to these matters, you know, it's too silly. The Quran is way above this. But regardless of these 2 points that I mentioned, I'm going to tell you how great was the transmission of the Quran according to our given way of thoughts, according to our experiments or whatever. I would like to highlight 2 points about the Quran, which in my imagination, the Western people, they don't understand one way, and many of the Muslims, they don't understand that point also. The Quran has been transmitted by 2 ways. First way, verbally from a person to another. Second way, by writing. And I look at the second way as secondary, it's not the most and main one. The first one is the most important one. And in my feeling, correct me if I'm wrong, the Western people, they will feel opposite. They feel that the Quran has been transmitted because of the written document, the scripture that we have. And that's why you hear 1 year ago about Birmingham script that they have, and a year before about Berlin script that they have, and you name it. But perhaps this because they don't have experience in it, you know. Most of their sciences, they are going to be transmitted according to the book. But let me speak about myself. I'm not going to speak about the others. I memorized the whole Quran. To be honest with you, I don't know which copy I did memorize the Quran from it. I did not keep it, you know. If you ask me which copy did you use, you know, to memorize the Quran, I'm sorry to tell you, I don't know. But if you ask me who was the person who gave you the Quran, I'm quite confident and sure about mentioning that person. You got my point? I think anyone who memorized the Quran in this life, he may have kept that copy, you know, with him back at home. But again, when he comes to a person like me, I'm going to ask him, on whom you have recited the Quran. I don't care about his copy a lot. Even though I know that his copy is a precise one, I have no doubt about the copy. But I care much more about the teacher who gave him this Quran. What I'm trying to say, in my view, the Quran has been transmitted from the first day of the Prophet ﷺ, up till now, up till our days. Even though we have millions and millions of these copies, it has been transmitted verbally by Sheikh and student. And in my view, from our generation to the coming generation, it's going to be transmitted as such. And this is, don't misunderstand me, I'm not here to put the copies of the Quran down. They are the greatest scripture ever you have. And I'm going to tell you about the history of them, you know, shortly. But here, just to highlight for myself and the others, the transmission of the Qur'an, the main resource to have this transmission of the Qur'an, they are the Berber transmission, which we call it mutawatir. What's the meaning of mutawatir? If you ask now the most expert in transmission and in the Islamic knowledge which has been transmitted, please bring me the evidence that Dhuhr prayer is for rak'ahs. And that person who went to the computer and brought you this large, you know, documents, all of them, they are narrations that Dhuhr is for rak'ahs. How do you feel about it? Do you think that this person give you the proof that Dhuhr is for rak'ahs? I say no. And the Dhuhr has been for rak'ahs not because of those documentation. And when I started praying Dhuhr for rak'ahs, I did not know about all of them, or perhaps 95% of them. How did we know that Dhuhr is for, they are for rak'ahs? Because in the time of the Prophet, you have thousands of people, they used to pray Dhuhr for rak'ahs. And they delivered this habit to much more thousands, and perhaps 10,000 or more of people. And these 10,000, they transmitted to 100,000 and more. And these 10,000, they transmitted to 100,000 and then to millions, and nowadays to billions, and we don't know to what end. So here, you are speaking about 1 billion chain or so of the transmission that the Dhuhr is for rak'ahs. You are not speaking about 500 or 6,000 or whatever. This is according up till now to the human ability. It's beyond the count, okay? It's much more than this. In the same way, I look at the Qur'an. The Qur'an has been transmitted in the same pattern. And when I seek the proof of the Qur'an, it's going to be exactly similar to this pattern of transmission that Dhuhr is for rak'ahs and not 3 or 2 or 5, okay? And by this, by the same way is the Qur'an. And this is regarding this way and regarding the Qur'an, you have it from the active side and the passive side. When you look at it from the passive side, it's going to duplicate many, many times. I give you an example of it. Back in Syria, I'm a teacher of Qur'an. If I taught my people to say, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, what's going to happen? I'm going to have massive objection about those teachers of the Qur'an in my city. What does this mean for me? When I teach people to say Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, even though actively they did not accept this, the other scholars, you know, back in my city, but passively they accept it, you know. Because whenever I have it in a wrong way, they are going to object. You got my point? In another way, what I'm trying to say, the one who learned Quran in my class, he did not learn Quran from so and so. He learned Qur'an from the whole city of Damascus. And this is give you much more broad look to the massive transmission that I'm speaking about. I hope that this point is quite clear, and it's a very important point. And this matter that we are speaking about, just imagine nowadays, when you travel to US or China, if you find a Muslim there, you know, you are going to find the same way of reciting the Quran. And if we ask The one who did not sound that religious person, you know. Don't pronounce in this way. This is what's written in your copy. Please adjust the notra. Pronounce it this way. I think this is better. What response you will receive for it? He's going completely to reject it. Let's say you have stolen his copy, you know, and you physically wrote down this. Instead of Alhamdulillah, Ash-Shukrillahi Rabbil Alameen. What is that person going to do? Nowadays, we are speaking about our time. He'll try quickly to get rid of this copy and find for himself in another copy of the Qur'an. Am I right or wrong? When we have such a behavior nowadays, all over the globe, what is our expectation about the companion and the successor? Okay? And here, if we are after those long days, you know, and this far distance, you know, we have this attitude toward the Qur'an. When we study how they used to be, how respectful they used to be to the Qur'an, and how precise they... If you don't believe me, let's go by the narration. You read in Bukhari, Uthman ibn Affan says, this is the one who has significant role in the Qur'an. He said, لا يهاجر مصحف اليوم. Yeah, no one has the authority to put or take away anything from the Mus'haf. This is narrated in Bukhari that this is the look, the statement of Uthman ibn Affan. I would rather, if you collect the data, as you know, even the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who is the person who should listen to him and learn Quran from him, in many occasions he used to show us that he has nothing to do with the Quran. The full authority is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How did I know this? You have some people, they came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam with some difference in style in reciting the Quran. And what did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam say? Did he say, I permit him to recite in this way? No. This is not what, this wasn't the expression of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What did he say? He said, hakaza unzilat. What's the meaning of hakaza unzilat? As if the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself was full and high respect, and we should listen to him, whatever he instructed us, even if he told us to recite this surah in this way or that way, he tells us that this is not, did not come from his side. It descended. This is the way it was descended, which means from where? From Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay. All those looks, I would like to understand them very well, you know, before touching certain points, you know, of the history of the transmission of the Quran. How the Quran was transmitted? For sure, I should ask everyone, you are speaking about the hidden chain or the manifested chain? You have to? Yes, we have to. We have the hidden chain, namely from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala till the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If I'm left alone, I'm not going to know anything about it. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in some verses in the Quran, gave us some idea about it. Firstly, how it's manifested, you know, in Umm al-Kitab, al-Lawh al-Mahfuz, the tablet. Then how it descends, you know, all the way, either to the other tablets, or according to Ibn Abbas, to the house of honor in the first heaven, and how it took all the way down to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the cave of Hira. And this by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala description, it took how many years? 1,000 years. And how many creation you have them involved in it? Some of us may feel or think that it's only Jibreel. No, you have a lot, massive amount of angels, you know, They got themselves, you know, involved in it. When Surah Al-An'am was revealed, the Prophet said, join it 70,000 of the angels. Then, let's speak for sure, I'll not good one, you know, to speak about the spiritual or non-physical chain of the Qur'an. Anyone who is interested, you know, in the non-physical or the chain, I encourage him to go and read carefully Al-Hawameen. Start by Hameen. Tanzeelu Kitab min Allah al-Azhar al-Alim. This is Surah Ghafir. Till the last Hameen. These seven surahs, you know, in the Qur'an, they tell you about the hidden chain. How was it initiated from Allah? Through the angels, through the messenger, till the nation. And this tells you about the hidden or not seen chain. And to my surprise, most of the narration they said, these hawameem, they are put in the Qur'an in the same order that they were read by. And you have this chain in the same order it was revealed and it was put in the Holy Qur'an. But I'm going to concentrate much more about the physical chain that we have. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam from day one, he was interested, you know, in having the Qur'an memorized and written down. You have in some narration that even the first revelation, which was in the Sayyidina Jibreel, when he had this revelation, he brought it in a cloth of natural silk and it was written there. This is the setting of Allah. Most of the Arab areas, you know, Arab peninsula, they don't know how to write. Whereas in Mecca, Mecca was the first city in the Arab peninsula to have the Arabic writing introduced to it. It was done by Harb ibn Umayyah. Harb ibn Umayyah passed away roughly 20 years or more before the revelation. What I'm trying to say, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made these people of that particular city, which is going to receive the first revelation from Allah. Many of these people there, they are familiar with the Arabic writing. And they know how to write. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has plenty of writers, you know, in Mecca. And all portions of the Quran which was revealed, the Prophet would say for someone, you know, to have it written, you know. And he has written the document. If some of you, they are familiar with how Umar ibn Khattab became Muslim, which was quite early, and this is perhaps after 5 years of the start of the revelation, how did he become Muslim? He has a copy of Surah Taha in the house, not in the house of the Prophet, not in the house of Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, not in the house of Uthman ibn Affan, not in the house of Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah, in the house of his sister, who is at that time, at least for us, you know, may come in the importance, you know, number 20 or 25, which means that you have plenty of copies of Surah Taha. And by this way, Sayyidina Umar al-Khattab became Muslim. When he read that script. Okay. And the whole Quran was as such. When the Prophet immigrated to Medina, he faced this problem. The people of Medina, quite few of them, they know how to write. Majority of them, they don't know. And the Prophet ﷺ brought this smart idea to get over this problem. When they have the war prisoners, you know, of the Meccan people, you know, doing better, he made the condition to free some of them to teach 10 of the boys of Medina Munawwara. And by this smart idea, the Prophet ﷺ had the ability to spread all over the Medina the way of writing. And one of these people, boys, who had the chance to learn how to write, eventually he was the neighbor of the Prophet ﷺ. Teenager, very smart person, free, not married, no children, no wife, no children, and he's the neighbor of the Prophet ﷺ. And whenever the Prophet ﷺ has a revelation, he's going to call him right away. This is Sayyidina Zayd ibn Thabit. And that's why in the Madani time, you have an expert in writing al-Wahi. How many writers the Prophet ﷺ has? I can bring to you 45 names of his writers. And some of you, they get surprised. And I get surprised because in these old days, perhaps the kings, you know, like Caesar and Kisra and the others, they may have four or five, you know, around their area or palace or whatever. Whereas the Prophet ﷺ, we can name. We don't know about those who are not named. We can name for them, for him, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, 45 writers, which for me is a huge number. It's an impossible number. Yet, even though the Prophet ﷺ had that huge number of, you know, of writers, it became a specialty of Zayd ibn Thabit. And he was not alone, because as they written in Tirmidhi, he said, while we are writing the Qur'an in the presence of the Prophet ﷺ, and this is to mention one hadith about Sham or about Syria, so what's the point here? That he was with a group of people, you know, writing the Qur'an in the house of the Prophet ﷺ, in the presence of the Prophet ﷺ. Besides all of these matters, Sayyidina Jibreel used to come to the Prophet ﷺ every Ramadan on yearly basis just to go over the whole Qur'an which was revealed up till that time during the months of Ramadan. And in the last Ramadan of the holy life of the Prophet ﷺ, Sayyidina Jibreel came twice, you know, and get over the Qur'an twice. And Sayyidina Zayd ibn Thabit, the person that we spoke about him, you know, a moment ago, he attended the last Arad, we call it, when the Prophet ﷺ used to recite on Sayyidina Jibreel. Sayyidina Zayd ibn Thabit attended the last recitation of the Prophet ﷺ to Sayyidina Jibreel. By this, toward the end of the life of the Prophet ﷺ, we know that many scripts, they were written. Again, we know the name of 22 companion who used to memorize the whole Qur'an at the death of the Prophet ﷺ. But let's assume we don't have even one memorizer of the whole Qur'an at that point. Does this take away the meaning of tawatur? No. Why? Because for tawatur you need for each portion or each section of the Qur'an to be narrated as such. And it's not necessary if someone narrated Surah Al-Baqarah to narrate Al-Imran, or if he narrated Al-Imran to narrate Surah Nisa, or whatever, you know. Yet, besides those narrators who, I think they count hundreds or thousands, you know, of people, I'm going to mention to you shortly, you know, why they count that number. You have, in our time nowadays, we may bring a name of 22 or 23 person who memorized the whole Qur'an. The expectation to have much more, why? Because the way you would study the seerah of the Prophet ﷺ, you find out how eager was the Prophet ﷺ to convey the verses of the Holy Qur'an from his side, and then encouraging everyone, you know, to tell the others, you know, about it. From his side, in the Meccan setting, in many occasions he will get hurt, and he will be yani, having some negative, you know, reaction from some of those people, you know, in Mecca. Yet the Prophet ﷺ keep doing it till the extent the companion, who were quite few and not that strong, they felt sorry, you know, about it, and they decided among themselves, you know, let's one of us take this task. And the weakest one, physically in our scale, you know, said, Abdullah Mas'ud, he said, I'm going to take it, you know. Who was not well recognized, he was not looked at, you know, among the Meccan community as from Noel family or whatever. He said, I'm going to take over, and he started reciting the Quran. What you read in Bukhari, one day the Prophet ﷺ, in the majlis of the Qurayshi people surrounding him, many majalis, he start reciting when Najmi Ida Hawa. And he keep reciting it till he reached the end of it. And when he reached the end of it, where is a command of prostration, he performed prostration, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and everyone, believer, non-believer, jinn or humankind, they performed prostration. I'm not here to tell you about this story. I'm here to feel that such a story given to me, it means that this was the ordinary habit of the Prophet ﷺ to recite, to convey, to have the massive transmission of anything from the Quran. And that's why you read in Mi'raj. What do you read in Mi'raj? On the morning of that night, the first one to meet with the Prophet ﷺ was Abu Jahl. What did he ask him? Be careful about these points. What did he ask him? He said, anything new came last night? What does this mean? That means every morning the Prophet ﷺ is going to tell the Meccan people, Muslim or non-Muslim, about what has been revealed, you know, last night. And that's why Abu Jahl initiated this question to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. For sure, this is good reason when we explain that the whole Quran was written, you know, during that time, the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But it was not collected in one place. Why it was not collected in one place? Because as you may know, you may have addition, you may have abrogation, or you name it, okay? And here, it's going to be much more harmful when you have a fixed copy, and a person is going to take it, you know, when you have something added after it. And this copy is not going to be a good copy, you know. Nowadays, if anyone buy a copy of the Mus'haf al-Sharif and you have a missed pages, you know, there, or one page, you are going to feel the deficiency of that. And this is for me explain, and it's very reasonable explanation why the Quran was not collected completely in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because of this factor. Whereas, as we know now, that we have massive transmission verbally of the Quran, and massive transmission writing, you know, of the Quran. When the collection of the Quran start, year 12, the Prophet ﷺ passed away in year 11. In year 12, Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq initiated the collection of the Quran. But he put a condition here. What is the condition? It's not only to bring your script, you know. You should bring two witnesses with you that this is was written in the presence of the Prophet ﷺ. Okay? And here, when we relate our Quran by our chain, or we call in Arabic isnad, to the Prophet ﷺ, we are not going to relate it only verbally. For sure, I said the verbal one is the most important one. We are going to relate it verbally and writing-wise. So, he put this condition, I'm not going to accept any of those collection of the written document or the script unless you have two witnesses that this was written in the presence of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this is narrated in Bukhari. And by this, Sayyidina Abu Bakr collected this copy. And the one who was in charge of this, who was the one in charge, was Sayyidina Zayd ibn Thabit. Who is Sayyidina Zayd ibn Thabit? One of, or perhaps not one, the most expert, you know, in writing Qur'an, and the one who attended the last Arab we mentioned, you know, about Qur'an, done by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to Sayyidina Jibreel. In the time of Sayyidina Uthman ibn Affan, for sure, there's a gap. And in this time, as we read, in the time of Sayyidina Abu Bakr, time of Sayyidina Umar, first years, you know, of Sayyidina Uthman ibn Affan, you have many of those copies, you know, they are taken from this original copy. And that's what we read. But Sayyidina Uthman ibn Affan, on year 25 of Hijra, he made it official, you know, and he wrote, we have some controversy between 5 or 8 copies of that collected copy, and he sent it to all major cities, you know, in Islam, namely Mecca, Damascus, Kufa, Basra, Medina, and we have in some narration Yemen, Bahrain, and he kept one for himself called the Mus'haf al-Imam. And the people, all of them, they start copying according to this. But this is not the matter of the copy. Sayyidina Uthman ibn Affan assigned a reciter of the Qur'an to go with the copy. See, and here, the combination between recitation and script never stopped. Even Sayyidina Uthman ibn Affan, when he sent these copies, which is copy, he sent or assigned a person to be in charge of teaching that copy. You want the names? We have the names. For the Madani copy, Zayd ibn Thabit. For the Makki copy, Abdullah ibn Sa'id. For the Shami copy, Mughira ibn Abi Shihab. For the Basri copy, Amir ibn Abdul Qais. For the Kufi copy, Abu Abdul Rahman al-Sulami. We have the names of those recites of the Quran who were sent, you know, with these copies, you know, of Sayyidina Uthman ibn Affan. And by this, how do you feel about it? I feel about it. Here you have, which I may explain it physically as a mountain. You have a mountain of transmission. The way I describe for you how the dhuhr is, they are for rak'ahs or whatever. You have many in your Islamic practice nowadays that we practice it. We may not know how definite and how confidential it was transmitted, but really it was massively transmitted in a way that when you look at your life, you hardly find anything similar to it, you know, in your life practice. And we have these chains, you know, of the Quran. They were kept all the time, or getting more and more. One of the latest scholars who passed away year 832, Ibn al-Jazari, in his book, he wrote down 1,000 chains. If you have it written in one book, you know 1,000 chains. What do you expect? How many chains do you have? For sure he made a lot of ikhtisar. Why? Because it's almost impossible to come. Yani, let's put it in a very simple way. All of those 1,000 chains, they are shuyukh of Ibn al-Jazari. How many persons in the time of Ibn al-Jazari in year 832 used to memorize the Quran? Give me a number. If we said 100,000, they may be much more. Okay? You got this point? And here, if you have a person who wrote down 1,000 chains, you know, even though he's very highly educated, you know, in Quran, you expect to have thousands and thousands of these chants, you know, which was not written. Okay. So again, what I'm trying to say, those chants that we see of Quran, they are only a symbol, they are an example of it. They don't tell you about the Quran, how it was transmitted, because as I illustrated for the Dhuhr prayer for rak'ahs, okay? And in this way, we should look at the Quran. Shall we stop here or five more minutes? More minutes. What was the second question? Let me see what was the question. You try to answer them.
The relevance of the Quran to this generation right now, citing specific examples.
Okay. I look at the Quran as story books. Okay. I think number three, question number three, I answered it already. So we are left with two questions, you know, the relevance, you know, between the Quran and our time. I think we are in real need of the Quran nowadays. Why? As a Muslim, firstly, we should receive your instructions from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As we said at the beginning, whenever you speak about anything religious, religion is a matter of transmission, it's not a matter of experiment. The second point, which is too important, nowadays I feel most of people, even many Muslims, you know, they became too materialistic. They don't have their relation with the spiritual matter. And the Quran is a very good way, you know, of relating themselves, you know, to the spiritual matter, which I look at it as real need of our humanity nowadays. So the relation between the new coming generation and the Quran, it should be as it used to be, you know, in the old days, by all aspects. What do I mean by them? Firstly, you should have a plenty of recitation of the Quran. To be honest with you, out of my experience, we are not good, that good in it. Even the adult, even the Arabic speaker, the one who is non-Arabic speaker, feel that the Arab, they are much better than to recite the Quran. I'm sorry to tell you, the Arab, they have the same problem, you know, of reciting the Quran. Here, yeah, the problem, I look at it, you know, as if most of us, we don't have the relation that we should have with the Quran. I'm going to bring you this story, you know, I don't know how accurate is it or what. I used to visit UK, Britain many times. And one time, a Pakistani person, a non-Arabic speaker, you know, British person, he asked me, I want word from you. I told him, you should recite Quran. I said, I cannot. I told him, I don't care, we should recite Quran. Okay. No other word, no, that's it, Quran. You should recite Quran. He called me 4 months later, telling me that he finished the first khatam. This amazed me a lot. Why? Not for that particular person. It amazed me a lot. Because many of us, Arab and non-Arab, We feel ourselves, you know, incapable of having one khatam. And it's a matter of try. You may have some mistakes, you may have some difficulties, you may have some bad time, you may have this or that. But when you try to make it, you know, once after another, you are going to find yourself to have better relation with the Quran. In my view, correct me if I'm wrong, you never ever have the Quran available for everyone as you have it nowadays. I have seen many programs, you know, computer programs. You may hear the recitation which me like about the famous reciter of the Quran. You may have it in different way written. You may have different interpretation, different tafsir or whatever, different translation. In another way, what I'm trying to say, I don't think this was available, you know, 50 years ago or so. Okay, that means the availability of the Quran nowadays, in my view, is much, much higher than any time before this. Even the one who is completely illiterate about Quran, when he hears the reciters of the Quran and how to recite the Quran, he's going to be much better than many of those skillful, you know, in the Quran, in reciting the Quran. Okay? You got my message? What I'm trying to say, we should get ourselves used to have some recitation of the Quran. I'm sorry to tell you, and this is not for the people here in the US, this is for most of the people, you know, even in the Muslim countries, and perhaps including myself. I have the habit of reading many things. I'm sorry to tell you, perhaps I give my interest, you know, and my skill of reading to read many, many books, you know, besides the Quran, which is completely wrong, okay? I should give most of this skill to read the Quran. How did I know it, you know? We look at the non-Muslim people, you know. They read this story, they read this book, they read this, they read that, they try to get some piece of information from here or there. Those who study in the university, you know, or elsewhere, again, they are going to have the same attitude. In Islam, we have something besides it, which is what? You have this Quran. It's not a matter of looking in your eye to the Quran and understand the meaning. This is one of the good way, you know, of building relation with the Quran. But besides this, you should have the recitation. And out of experience with some people, you know, when you have the voice coming, it's going to affect you. And it was brought to my attention recently, you know, which amazed me a lot. Well, this is, I think this is in the internet. They showed me it from the internet that a sheikh speaking, you know, he was in a committee. Most of the people in the committee, they were not Muslim. And they have certain way of measuring the flow of the tone. And they use it for what? For songs. I don't know if anyone of you is familiar with this. I'm not familiar with it. I'm sorry, okay? And out of their fund, they asked that sheikh, do you have something that you can measure here? He said, yes, I have something. And he brought them, you know, a recording of Al-Husayn rahimahullah ta'ala. The result, what was the result? The best song, it took 80% of success. How much the recording of Husayn took? It took 100%. For sure, I know that Husayn is skillful, you know, in reciting. Perhaps I may not get this, you know. But besides this, you have the choice of this wording and the way they are put in the Quran. It has a very effective way, you know, to penetrate, to affect your heart, soul, to affect many of the well-known and not well-known, you know, portion of your body. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, تَقْشَعِرُوا مِنْهُ جُلُودُ الَّذِينَ يَخْشَوْنَ ثُمَّ تَلِينُ جُلُودُهُمْ وَقُلُوبُهُمْ. The skins and the heart, which means in another way, that you have a way of recitation. This has nothing to do with reading a book, with understanding the meaning of the book. Stop here for a minute. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الحمد لله الذي حمدا يوافي نعمه ويكافئ مزيده يا ربنا لك الحمد كما ينبغي لجلال وجهك وعظيم سلطانك سبحانك لا نحصي ثناء عليك انت كما اثنيت على نفسك نستغفرك ونتوب اليك وأفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم على سيد الأولين والآخرين وعالم السابقين وقائد الغر المحجلين وسيد ولدي آدم أجمعين اللهم صل وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله الغر الميامين وأصحابه نجوم الدين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وعنا معهم برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين اللهم لا سهل إلا ما جعلته سهلا وأنت تجعل الحزن إذا شئت سهلا اللهم ألهمنا رشدنا وأعذنا من شرور أنفسنا اللهم انفعنا وارفعنا بالقرآن العظيم اللهم اجعله لنا نورا وإماما وهدى ورحمة أما بعد dear brothers and sisters inshallah try to shed some light you know about certain points you know how to implement the Holy Quran to our life which is one of the most, or it is the most important thing, you know, in this life. You know, that this Qur'an was revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as described, وَقُرْآنًا فَرَقْنَاهُ لِتَقْرَأَهُ عَلَى النَّاسِ عَلَى مُكْثٍ وَنَزَّلْنَاهُ تَنْزِيلًا. This is the main purpose, you know, of the revelation of the Qur'an, to be read on the people, you know, in a periodical way and to have the 13 while we are reading it. So, as we see in this verse, the first way of implementing the Quran in our life to try to recite the Quran. Okay? And this is the first step to be taken, you know, to have your relation with the Quran Kareem is to start reciting the Quran. وَرَتَّلْنَاهُ تَرْتِيلًا. That means this is the way we should handle it by. And this is what has been practiced by the Prophet ﷺ and by his companion. The Prophet ﷺ attracted many persons, you know, by only reciting the Quran without anything, you know, beyond this point, you know. Even some of the non-believers, they used to spend the whole night listening to the Prophet ﷺ. Then they had a problem with Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, because again Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq used to have very nice recitation of the Holy Quran, and the women and the children of the non-believer, they will go and just listen to the Quran, and they were fearful or afraid that they may be affected, you know, by the recitation of Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. And when the people of Yemen, they came to Medina, as narrated, wherever or whenever they hear Quran, they start crying, you know. Sayyid Bakr as-Siddiq said, we used to be as such, you know, in the past. And this is, all of these matters tells us that it's initiated by reciting the Quran. Reciting the Quran is going to build your relation with the Quran. I would rather say it became many non-Muslim, Muslim in the time of the Prophet ﷺ. Even in our time, you know, I went to the southern region of Spain, and a Muslim person there, he told me that, I asked him, how did you become Muslim, you know? He said, I traveled to Morocco, you know, and there I hear the Quran, and this was the first, the beginning of his story, you know, to become a Muslim, you know. And this effect, this matter, personally myself, we tend to forget them, you know. We don't feel the importance of them the way they should be felt, okay? That's why this idea came to me yesterday, you know. I don't know how practical it's going to be in this mosque, you know. In Egypt, you have good reciter of the Qur'an, he may give recitation, you know, for half hour or more or less, okay? And I think this is a good idea for those who are thirsty, you know, listening to Qur'an, to have it, you know, done in this mosque, you know, and have some people share this, you know, and have, even I look forward to have it in all countries, you know, back in my country, that not all people, you know, they will be going, you know, through the tough task, you know, of learning tajwid, especially the way I teach people, you know. But I look forward to have people break their barrier between them and the Qur'an by at least having them, you know, reading some verses of the Qur'an. And I look at them at these steps, you know, as the first initiation, you know, to improve our relation with the Holy Qur'an. Besides this, there's another important practice or point that should be taken, which we tend to forget it a lot, or out of our conditions nowadays, you know, we are not that good, you know, in practicing, which is what? Night prayer. Okay? Night prayer is one very good way, you know, of fixing your relation and finding your relation with the Holy Quran. One of the companion, while he was reciting overnight the Quran, as narrated in Bukhari and elsewhere, he starts seeing candles, you know, coming down from the heaven to or from the sky toward himself, you know. And this is, has been mentioned in very vivid way. And the Prophet Sallallahu said, if you kept reciting till the morning, they are going to stay there, you know, and have everyone observe them. And this is by itself, for sure. I don't have this experience, you know, but it sounded like a unique experience of building your relation with the Holy Quran. Okay, to try to enjoy your times, for sure. For such a person, it was joyful, you know, moments, you know, when you have these extraordinary matters taking place, you know, around you. And I'm sorry to tell you nowadays, because of the power, you know, we spend significant portion of the night waking up, you know, speaking with each other, and we miss this great prayer, you know. I'm sorry, I look at the power, you know, as the main factor, you know, of having all of us, you know, or most of us missing the night prayer. I'm sorry to tell you, when I went to Virginia, a sheikh there, he said, he interpreted this hadith that the shaitan is going to have his death, you know, in the ear about fajr prayer. This is never the case, okay? Fajr prayer is obligation. You have no choice, you know, of anything rather than doing it in its time, you know. But the Prophet ﷺ, what he meant, you know, by this hadith was the night prayer, not fajr prayer, okay? And this is really important. I just, why did I tell you about this story? To tell myself and the other how far we got from the night prayer, okay? To the extent that in many occasions we try to explain many of these ahadiths or the others, you know, by fajr prayer. Fajr prayer, no, it's out of negotiation. You don't have anything to discuss about it. After that, I try to help myself, you know, to implement Quran by what has been mentioned by the Prophet ﷺ. In one hadith, the Prophet ﷺ divided the Quran to seven different subjects. These subjects of the Quran, they are not put in order that you have the first portion of this and the second one. They are, in my view at least, looked at as the subject mixed all together, you know, in the whole Quran. And you, by yourself, you know, or by the help of the other, we should recognize and separate this from the other one and try to give each one what it deserves. What do I mean by this? The Prophet ﷺ, in this hadith, he divided the Quran to seven different subjects. The first subject is muhkam, explicit. The second one is mutashabih, figurative or obscure. The third one is Amir, that means commands. The fourth one is zajir, or prohibitions. The fifth one, examples, amsal. The sixth one, qasas, stories. Seventh one, maw'idha, admonition, or preaching. In some narration of this hadith, the Prophet instructed us how we should react according to what we recite. He said, follow the steps of the commands. Avoid what we are prohibited to do. Practice the explicit one. Believe in the figurative one, okay? The figurative one or the square one, you may not be able to know it. You should at least believe in it. اعتبروا بأمثالي, that means to think thoroughly about the examples, you know, and see what's meant, you know. What did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mean by them? Okay? And in some other narration, and you should get your admonition, you know, from the preaching, you know, in the Qur'an. Besides the stories. Okay. So here, the Prophet ﷺ gave all of us the summary about the common meanings in the Qur'an. You are going to find most places, or all places of the Qur'an speak about one of these seven different subjects. And for each subject, it's not a matter of knowing it, it's a matter of practicing it. And the Prophet ﷺ guided us how to practice these seven different subjects. And this is a way of understanding the Qur'an. A way of building your relation of Qur'an. After you start reciting the Qur'an, I think the second step is going to be to memorize the Qur'an, and the third one, to act upon what you know, okay? Respond to the Qur'an, okay? They said, أَطِيعُ اللَّهَ. This is mentioned in many verses in the Qur'an. You have the ability to obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala directly? No. You have it in indirect way by obeying what has been instructed to you or shown to you by the Qur'an. Okay. Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq, in one statement when he spoke to Sayyidina Abu al-Khattab, he highlighted different views. Yani as may I understand and show the others, here we have different look to the Qur'an. And the best among us, those who have different views about the Qur'an, and they try to practice all of them, and they try to apply them to their life. So here you have this look, you know, which has been mentioned by the Prophet ﷺ about seven different times. You have this look from Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq when he subdivided the verses of the Qur'an to Jalali and Jamali, majestic and beautiful one, you know. And he said Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala joined them together in most areas of the Qur'an just to make the servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had the full desire in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and being fearful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This one way of dealing with the Qur'an, okay? We should try to practice the Qur'an through having these large, great hopes, wishes in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and through being fearful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And some of us, they may hate, or not hate, let's say not hate, they may dislike or they don't get along with certain verses of the Qur'an. I did meet with some people, you know, they have this matter. Here, if they don't like those verses, you know, speaking about the hellfire or whatever, when they are mentioned the Qur'an, that means it's your need, this is a human need of the Qur'an. And you should not only build your relation with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, build your relation with the Qur'an only through the wishes, you know, and the hope that you have full desire to practice. Also, you should build it through the warning pattern of the Qur'an. And this is one part of the names of the Prophet ﷺ, Bashiran Nadhiran. Inna arsalnaka shahidan wa mubashiran wa nadhira, to bring the good tidings, the good news, and to bring the warning news, or this news that we don't like to hear you. As a matter of fact, we read in Sirah, when the Prophet ﷺ started to uncover his da'wah, his invitation to everyone, after 3 years of the hidden invitation, he climbed the mountain of Safa, and he gave an example about something related to warning sign, not to good news, you know. He said, if by assumption you have a person came telling you that you have an army raiding against Mecca, you know, behind that mountain. If I told you about this, the Prophet ﷺ related it to himself, are you going to believe in me? They said, yes, because we never tried any lie from your side. He said, then I am the Nazir, I am the warner for you from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This was the first word to be mentioned, and this is derived from the Qur'an, وَأَنذِرْ عَشِيرَتَكَ الْأَقْرَبِينَ. It's derived from this. So here, what I'm trying, don't be deviated, okay? I'm not telling you to just collect all of those warning verses, you know, in the Qur'an. No, you should collect both of them, the good news and the warning news from the Qur'an, and you should work according to them, you know, in your life. And you need them. And as Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq told Sayyidina Umar, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala joined them together to have all of his servants, you know, they have the post practices, you know, in all of their life. And this is one way of implementing the Qur'an to your life, okay? Here, I look at it as a balanced way between what we call in Arabic, raja and khawf, your hope and your fear from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And any of us who is deviated, let's say in his hope, is deviated extremely to the hope, this means that he is secure, he feels himself secure of what we call makrullah, or anything done from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's side, and this is was counted as an enormity. لا يأمن مكر الله إلا القوم الخاسرين. Those who are losers. And this is read in the Quran. If it's in the other way, deviated toward the warning verses, you know, he may get to the region that's called despair. He despaired of the mercy of Allah. And this is another enormity, okay? And as you may see, as we are modest, you know, in most of our practices in Islam, and in your relation with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you should be modest, okay? You should have the balanced way between raja and khawf, or between wishes, you know, and fear. And the best way of handling these two matters, you know, is to recite the Quran. This is going to build your relation with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in that regard. By reciting the Quran, we are going to find yourself how we are going to take them in the well-balanced way. When we speak about what we have spoken about yesterday, when the Prophet ﷺ divided the Quran in another hadith to 4 different sections, and he said that the first section is the substitute of the Torah, or the Old Testament, the second section is substitute of the Gospel, the third section is substitute of the Psalm or the book of Sayyidina Dawood, and the last one is special for this nation. Again, when you understand the common meaning of this previous book, you should understand the message given to you from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in these different sections, you know. I expect in the first section, you know, to see a rules, see regulations, see commands, see prohibitions, because these are the main instruction given in the Old Testament, and for sure the Quran contains a lot of them, and I'm going to expect most of them, not all of them, most of them in the first section. When you look at the second section, for sure your expectation should be about the spiritual matter. Because the gospel and the nature of Sayyidina Isa and Maryam speak deeply, you know, and in a specialized way about the spiritual matter, and you look forward to have them, you know, in this section. When we look at the third one, for sure we are going to look at some wording, you know, some verses to praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to have them in the dhikr form, to have them in this or that, okay? And this is, I look at it as a common relation, you know, of practice your relation with Allah, with the Holy Quran. Then, some people, they said alif lam mim, it's a reflection of the materialistic matter. Islam, one of its greatness, you know, that it deals with the materialistic, the physical objects that you deal with, and the spiritual one. And whenever we are deviated toward one against the other, it's against Islam, okay? And this is, I think, the Muslims, they have this problem nowadays. Even in US, you know, you have many people, you know, they feel their need for the spiritual matter. They don't become Muslim. They go to Buddhism or something else. Why? This is because your people as Muslim, you are quite deficient, you know, in this matter. If they feel that their needs, you know, of the spiritual matters, they are met, you know, in your Islam, they will not search for the Buddhism or other religion. What I'm trying to say, that the Muslim practice, not only in the US, all over the world, in my view, has been deviated to the materialism much more. And this is not the original Islam. The original Islam, to have the balanced way. For sure, the Islam did not instruct you to be in bad shape and just take care of your heart and your soul or spirit or whatever. He wants you to take care of all matters, you know, related to your body and related to your spirit or to your soul. And by this way, you are going to fulfill the all needs of yourself, you know, as a humankind. When you say humankind, in my view, I'm speaking about two components, the physical component and the non-physical component. How come most of Muslims nowadays, they deny the other one? They don't speak about it. I hardly hear anyone, you know, speaking about it. And we have a lot of speaking, you know, about how to have a board of trustees, how to raise up money, how to make fundraising, how... You see, we hear a lot of these, you know, activities, you know, but we don't hear a lot, you know, about the other spiritual matters, okay? And this is completely opposite to the way the Prophet used to have. For sure, you should look at the Qur'an as zikr, okay? Qur'an is looked at as one of the best zikr that you have. Even some of those famous shuyukh, what did he say? Whenever you want to say, let's say, La ilaha illallah, rather than saying La ilaha illallah from your side, you try to look at this observation. You try to recite it as a part of the Quran. That's why you hear it, you know, in many occasions. They say, فَعْلَمْ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ اللَّهُ. Why they started by فَعْلَمْ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ اللَّهُ? Because this is part of the verses, you know, mentioned لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ. And by this, you got my point? And even when you make dhikr, we have been instructed by the Prophet ﷺ to have 33 times of Subhanallah, 33 times of Alhamdulillah, 33 times of Allahu Akbar after each prayer. Rather than saying it from my side, I'm going to say it from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's side, from the Holy Quran. I'll get, even if I want to be materialistic there, I'm going to take 10 hasana for each letter there when I try to recite the Quran. Besides that, we are reciting Quran, okay? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in one hadith, Qudsi, أَنَا جَلِيسُ مَنْ زَكَرِي. I'm going to sit with the one making dhikr of me. And I think the best setting, you know, to have this, to have the Holy Quran, to sit down and recite Quran and build your relation with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In my view, I may be too poor, you know, in it, you know, but I know for sure, whenever anyone practices this way of sitting with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is going to gain much more relation with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Just I take it by the example that we have it nowadays, okay? When you have one of your boys or girls, you know, sit down a lot and get a friendship, you know, with another boy or another girl, you know, of his age, you are going to find gradually that he is affected by that person. He has some of his attitude, some of his behavior, some of his characters, you know, has been changed. Okay. By this, I would like to have mind changed, you know, according to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not according to humankind. And this is, how do I gain it? By sitting with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How do I sit by Allah? By remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why you have few surahs or few verses in the Qur'an has been highlighted by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to make dhikr of it. Example of it, Surah Yasin. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam encouraged us a lot, you know, to recite Surah Yasin. Encouraged us a lot to recite Surah Qul Huwallahu Ahad. Encouraged us a lot to recite قُلْ أَعُوذُ رَبِّ الْفَلَقِ وَقُلْ أَعُوذُ رَبِّ النَّاسِ. And we have many other تَبَارَكَ الَّذِي بِيَدِهِ الْمُلْكُ for each night. Okay, آيَةُ الْكُرْسِي for those who did not know about it, you know, in one hadith, anyone who recites Ayatul Kursi after each prayer, there's nothing to prohibit him of entering the heaven except this. Okay? And he doesn't have any barrier between himself and the heaven except this. And this leads us to the question written there, what's about Surah Al-Kahf? They said that first 10 verses of it, you know, if I'm right, you know, in some narration you have the first 10 verses and another narration you have the 5 last verses, you know, of it. But in one narration mentioned by Abu Ya'la, whenever you recite Surah Al-Kahf on Friday, you are going to be protected of all fitan. For me, to be honest with you, it sounded great for me. Why? Because I see our time, you know, as time of fitan. And I would like for myself, I would like for my family, I would like for my friends, and I would like for everyone to have this, these ways, you know, of protection given to him, you know, by what? By reciting Surah Al-Kahf. What's the relation between Surah Al-Kahf and be protected of these matters? You have many, many factors there. One of them, you started by saying Alhamdulillah. Okay. To be honest with you, most of our fitan nowadays, because of something given to us, you know, and we have been abusive to it. Either we abuse the food consumption, or we abuse the computer which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it available to us, or whatever. So here, when you say Alhamdulillah, you try to descend the barakah, the blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for these items. When I look really, you know, thoroughly nowadays, I would like, I see that the humanity nowadays, they are drowned in the favors of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which never happened to anyone in the past. I came to you, you know, within few hours, you know. If I want to use the old vehicle, it's going to take me months to reach this area, or much more. You got my point? Yeah. In the way I moved here, it was much more sophisticated than the ways of the kings, the old kings, okay? When you have the air condition, when you have the heating, when you have all these types, you know, of food, you have all these vehicles, the cars, you know, parking outside, you have this carpet, you have different type of clothes, different type of colors, different type of fruit, and you name it, you know, all of these items, we feel that are natural, and this is the way, you know, it should be. But when you read in the books, this was not the way for our parents, you know, or grandparents. And here, when you start Surah Al-Kahf by saying Alhamdulillah, and what's included in it to highlight many of those major favors given to you, namely your age, by the story of Ashab Al-Kahf, because they have long life, okay? The Ashab Sahib Al-Jannatain, the one who has two gardens, you know, and this may resemble many of our luxurious life nowadays, then speaking about the knowledge. Many of us, you know, they are proud of their knowledge or their education or whatever. We have the story of Sayyidina al-Khadr, who one of his significance was his knowledge, you know, when he met with Sayyidina Musa. Then you have the kingdom, you know, you have that famous king, Dhul Qarnayn. And I'm not going to speak about Surah Kahf in many aspect, but just I highlight that this surah speak about many of those major and minor favors, you know, given to you from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And most of us, they look at it as an ordinary way to have it, you know. They don't look at the greatness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to have them available to us, okay. And when we keep thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we are going to have the unique protection, you know, of going to fitna. We have the unique protection of having this item taken away from us. Is it a possibility? Yes, it's a very strong possibility. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, ذَلِكَ بِأَنَّ اللَّهَ لَمْ يَكُمْ مُغَيِّرًا نِعْمَةً أَنْعَمَا عَلَىٰ قَوْمٍ حَتَّى يُغَيِّرُ مَنْ. Allah is not going to change any favor given to any group of people till they start changing. Do you see that change? Yes, I do see that change, you know, among ourselves. We don't appreciate these favors from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on many occasions. In other occasions, we may abuse them, you know, in the sinful action, and you name it, you know. And all of these practices that we have, they may lead us to have these favors, you know, gone away, you know, from our hands. Another way of finding your relation with the Holy Quran is by inspecting those areas. Sometimes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, these are real signals, you know, or ayat to those who think. In such a verse, you should use your thought, think about it. The other one, intellectual. Use your intellect. Third one, ulul albab, those who have a core inside, okay? And here, not all of us, we have a core. Some of us, they have core, and the other, they don't have. And here, what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Qaf, inna fi dhalika lidhikra liman kana lahu qalbun aw alqa as-sam'a wa huwa shahid. Either you have a heart, and this heart is going to lead you to understand that verse or that chapter in the Quran, or if you don't have a heart, it's not the end of the story. You should search and find a person who has a heart, and you be a good listener to that person. Either you have a heart, or you listen to the one who has a heart. And this is what mentioned, إِمَنْ كَانْ لَهُ قَلْبٌ أَوْ أَلْقَ السَّمْعَ وَشَيْءٍ. I look, I'm sorry, up till now I haven't done it, you know, perfectly the way it should be done. But I feel many of those verses in the Holy Quran, they are going to direct you, you know, to use your different skills. Here, قَوْمًا يُبْصِرُونَ. You should use your eye, your sight. قَوْمًا يَسْمَعُونَ. You should use your hearing, and you name it. As humankind, among the creation, perhaps we have the best skills given to us by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the best way of using our skills is to use it the way it has been designated in the Quran. Okay? Whereas, if I abuse them, how do I abuse them? If I use my intellect, you know, to judge my religion or to judge Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I have been abusive. Okay? And I misuse my skill which was given to me from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why? Because I should limit it to the areas that has been mentioned in the Quran. And there's very important quotation you have in the Quran about certain descriptions that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves a lot, or certain descriptions that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hates. You have it in the Quran, in Allah يحب الصادقين إن الله يحب المحسنين إن الله يحب الصابرين إن الله يحب التوابين إن الله يحب المتطهرين إن الله يحب المحسنين. Okay, these are the five, six items, you know, that has been initiated by the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you are interested in gaining the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you should search for these points, you know, in the Holy Quran and try to practice according to be truthful, to be patient, to be purified, to be to practice repentance most of the time, to be muhsin or perfect, you know, according to the different meaning of ihsan and unity. إن الله لا يحب الظالمين, those who are unjust. إن الله لا يحب so and so. So again, in the same pattern, you look at those who are hated by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and try to keep yourself away of these matters. In other words, the Quran is not a story. The Quran is not a theology. Quran is something to be practiced. Some may say, does it fit our time? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed this Quran to fit all times. And this is one of the meaning of لَا يَأْتِهِ الْبَاطِلُ مِنْ بَيْنِ يَدَيْهِ وَلَا مِنْ خَلْفِهِ. You are not going to have anything, you know, fake about Quran before or after. And that's what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam described, لَا يَخْلَقُ عَلَى كَسْرَةِ الرَّدْ وَلَا تَنْقَضِي عَجَائِهِ. You feel it? Yes, I feel it. Why? Because now I'm around 60 years. How many times did I repeat Fatiha? To be honest with you, up till now, when I recite the Fatiha, I don't feel bored of it, you know. But if you are going to give me any word, you know, in this, in the whole world, you know, any statement or any text similar to Fatiha, after repeating it a few times, I'm going to get fed up of it. Why? Because this is the wording of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's one of the meaning, لَا يَخْلَقُ عَلَى كَثْرَةٍ. You are not going to feel yourself, you know, get fed up or filled of the Qur'an, regardless of how many times you recite it. Okay? وَلَا تَنْقَضِ عَجَائِبُ. The way, and it was put according to our standard in very excellent and smart way. You see, that the Qur'an, which was revealed in the 7th century, Gregorian century, was not objected by anyone in that time of those who make sense or they have some education or some scientific look. And you find that nowadays you have the same thing. The Qur'an nowadays doesn't contradict with any of the scientific facts that we have nowadays. Even though many of those facts or many of these looks has been changed over the year, but the Qur'an put it in such a way to fit the understanding of the previous people and our understanding. And by the same pattern is going to fit the understanding of the coming generations. And I look at this as one of the miracles of the Prophet. What is it? That he did not give tafsir of the Qur'an. I look at it as one of the miracles of the Prophet. Why he did not give tafsir of the Qur'an? Because if that tafsir is going to be according to the 7th century, we are going to freeze the whole Qur'an. And it's, the Qur'an doesn't fit by this way to all times and all places. If he gave tafsir, let's say, of our time, this is will be like crazy, you know, for those people, and they may not imagine it or you. So here, I look at this behavior from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as a great miracle of his sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the most and the best person, you know, to handle and take care of the Quran. I should ask myself, why he did not give tafsir of the whole Quran, starting from the beginning till the end? Because if he did so, we are going to have one of these problems that I have spoken about. Yani at least we are going to freeze the Quran. And the Quran, by these two matters mentioned by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is going to be flexible, you know, for all times and all communities. Okay. I have spoken, you know, with you about the positive point, how to implement Quran. Let's speak about the negative point. You had many factors in your life take you away from the Holy Quran. I'm sorry, I did not prepare myself, you know, but I would like everyone, you know, to go back and read carefully what's called Salat Hafz al-Quran. Because in one of my lectures, I found that each item mentioned there in the dua, Salat Hafz al-Quran, for those who are not familiar with it, you pray for rak'ahs, certain verses, you know, certain chapters of the Quran, then you make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I found this dua, really, each item or each sentence of it tell you about certain practice that is going to block you off getting the good relation with the Quran. Okay? Yani as we spoke positively, you know, about our relation with the Quran, we should look after those negative points that may prohibit us of having this relation with the Quran. What mentioned that dua? First, Allahumma arhamni bi tarki al-ma'asi abadan ma abqayta. This is one of the main barrier between you and the Quran. Whenever you commit sin, you know, or you are a sinful person, this is going to create a significant barrier between you and the Quran. Another one, I'm sorry, I may not remember all of them. That's why I encourage everyone to go back to them. وَأَنْ أَتَكَلَّفَ مَا لَا يَعْنِيهِ. One of the main wastage of time we have when we get ourselves, you know, involved in matters that it's not of our interest, you know. Okay? I should hear the news. What? Are you going to be a president, you know, or you are going to have, you know, some competition, you know, to go to the Senate or here or that? No, I just want to hear the news. Okay, hear the news. Hear this news, you know, given to you by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So here, I'm not telling you, you shouldn't hear the news, you know, but I just give example, okay? Here, when you look at your life on day-to-day basis, you are going to find many activities you do per day that they are wastage of time. They are not beneficial for this life, and for sure, I guarantee for you, they are not beneficial for the hereafter. And another one, that dua, oh Allah, bring the motivation to my heart to love the Quran. We should ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala this, and we should work hard to have the motivation toward the Quran. I'm sorry, as I told you at the beginning, I don't memorize all of these sentences, you know, mentioned by this hadith, but for me, it sounded very great, you know, just to see the practical point. I give this, you know, as one of the practical points, you know. As I said yesterday, the availability of the Quran nowadays never happened in the past. I have many people, you know, I look at them, they have the whole Quran in their iPhone. Okay, let's assume that you went to the doctor, you have an appointment with the doctor, and they told you, sorry, before 10 minutes, you cannot get in, okay? Why would it take these 10 minutes, you know, to open that iPhone and have few verses, you know, recited? Okay? Yani, in my view, all of us, we have busy life. If I'm going to wait till I have the free time, which is half hour or 1 hour, I may stay for days and days before achieving this, you know, to have the free time. So, in my attitude, I would like to steal a few minutes from here and a few other minutes from there, you know, and try to build my relation with the Holy Quran by this way. There's other spiritual matters, you know. I mean, don't have the time, you know, to go over them, you know. You have the spiritual matter, knowledge in Allah, love of Allah, confidence in Allah. All of these spiritual matters, they are going to drive you to learn the Quran more and more. I have been instructed to give the last 10 minutes, you know, for any question, if anyone has any question, you know. I'm sorry, perhaps I did not cover the subject in the way it should be covered, you know, but I leave the last 10 minutes, you know, for questions.
If any of you have questions, we will take, like, Isha is 8 o'clock, so we will stop before Isha. If anybody has questions, please. And sisters also. Yeah, please go.
The source of Salat Hafz al-Qur'an, it's mentioned in Sunan al-Tirmidhi and al-Mustadrak. This is the book of al-Hakim. And among your people, the one who has this small book, you know, called al-Dua al-Mustajab, written by Sheikh Ahmad Abdul Jawad, you have Salat Hafz al-Qur'an in it. If you want to be official, it's originally in Sunan al-Tirmidhi and Mustadrak al-Hakim. I don't know, perhaps we should have someone here, you know, to, and in UK, I have a person, you know, who printed, you know, Salat Hafz al-Qur'an for anyone who is interested. Let's have it in this community. If someone, you know, Ammo, he said he's going to do it, you know, to print, you know, Salat Hafz al-Qur'an. Anyone who is interested in it, you know, let him go back to Sayyidi Tariq to know about it, okay? And I encourage all of you, you know, to practice it. I know about a person who was memorizer of the Quran. When he heard about this hadith, he practiced this prayer after his hifz to Quran. And this prayer originally this to make the person hafiz of the Quran. He was already hafiz Quran. He prayed that prayer when he heard it from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Other question?
Any brothers?
I'm saying Muhammad Ali here.
Sayyidi, I have a problem with reciting Quran that usually the ayat that have the ahkam, when I'm reciting them, I just go over them quickly, like ayat al-mawarith and so on. I do not know how to relate well to these ayat and just consider them as instructions that I should know quickly and then go on.
This the question is that there's some ayat speaks about certain rule or regulations. And he feel himself that he go over them, you know, quickly without understanding the rules there. Is this the question?
No, even Sayyidi with understanding the rules, but يعني, for example, the ayat that have a story or relate to, for example, Ghazwat Badr, Ghazwat Uhud, يعني, I tend to think more about them, ponder more on them. Ayat al-Ahkam, I just go.
I think if I fully understand the question, this question has been asked and answered by Imam Nawawi in his book, At-Tibyan fi Bayan Adab Hamalat al-Quran. He said in that book, you have the controversy about should I read the Quran frequently or slowly and try to understand the meaning of it. And the answer was by Imam Nawawi. When you feel yourself that you are not that skillful, you know, in understanding the Quran, read more frequently. When you have the skills, slow down and try to understand these verses. This answer given by Imam Nawawi. Yes? Yes.
Just like Shaykh mentioned about, you know, the Quran is divided into like a seven parts. Is there any way we can find like which one is which?
As I said, for the seven, it's almost impossible because they are the subjects of the Quran. You may have two of them in one verse. Okay? When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give you a command and prohibition in one verse. Okay. But when we speak about the four divisions, yes, we know them. The first one starts from Surah Baqarah till Surah Tawbah. The second one starts from Surah Yunus till Surah Al-Furqan. The third one starts from Surah Al-Shu'ara till Surah Al-Hujurat. And the last one starts from Surah Al-Qaf till that. And as I understand, there are certain divisions, you know, in the Quran. You may take it, you know, by portions in the Quran. There's other divisions that you will not be able to do it as such. Other questions? Okay, inshallah, stop here, make everyone ready, prepare himself, you know, for Isha prayer. Wa sallallahu ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi.
سيدي طلبوا الجميع دعاء
يعني
لا طلبوا من الناس
الجميع سيد هذه والله لا يحصل
والله لو فكرت كل دعاء التوفيق طلب خاص
حاضر
جزاك الله خير
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الحمد لله حمدا وافي نعمه ويكافئ مزيده يا ربنا لك الحمد كما ينبغي لجلال وجهك وعظيم سلطانك سبحانك لا نحصي ثناء عليك انت كما اثنيت على نفسك استغفرك ونتوب اليك وافضل الصلاه واتم التسليم على سيدنا محمد الصادق الامين المبعوث رحمه للعالمين وعلى اله وصحبه اجمعين اللهم اسمعنا خيرا واطلعنا خيرا ورزقنا الله العافيه والأمة علينا وجمع الله قلوبنا على التقوى وفقنا لما يحب ويرضاه ربنا لا تؤاخذنا ان نسينا او اخطانا ربنا ولا تحمل علينا إصرا كما حملته على الذين من قبلنا ربنا ولا تحملنا ما لا طاقة لنا به واعف عنا واغفر لنا وارحمنا أنت مولانا فانصرنا على القوم الكافرين اللهم إنا عبيدك بنو عبيدك وبنو إمائك نواصينا بيدك ماض فينا حكمك عدل فينا قضاءك نسألك بكل اسم هو لك سميت به نفسك وأنزلته في كتابك وعلمته أحدا من خلقك واستأثرت به في علم الغيب عندك أن تجعل القرآن العظيم ربيع قلوبنا ونور صدورنا وجلاء حزننا وذهاب همنا وغمنا اللهم ذكرنا منه ما نسينا وعلمنا منه ما جهلنا وارزقنا تلاوته وآناء الليل وأطراف النهار على النحو الذي يرضيك عنا اللهم اجعله حجة لنا ولا تجعله حجة علينا اللهم اجعلنا ممن أقام حروفه ورسومه وحدوده ومعانيه ولا تجعلنا ممن أضاع حروفه ورسومه وحدوده ومعانيه اللهم نور بكتابك أبصارنا وأطلق به ألسنتنا واشرح به صدورنا واستعمل به أجسادنا بحولك وقوتك فإنه لا حول ولا قوة إلا بك يا أرحم الراحمين واغفر اللهم لنا ولوالدينا ولمشايخنا ولمن له حقا علينا ولسائر المسلمين أجمعين ربنا تقبل منا بجاه النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم السر الفاتح. Thank you.